Well, thank you so much for being here. I don't know. If I go on extemporaneously, I'll go into my John Boehner imitation and need my box of tissues, so I better get down to what I've prepared to say in a cool-headed way. But deepest thanks for your presence. I'm grateful to, and let me say this right at the beginning here, I'm grateful to Gina Duffy, Laura Matthews, Darren Poley, who just made the introduction, Joanne Quinn, who did this beautiful poster. The folks here in Falvey do such a terrific job, so many thanks to you folks. And to Peter Spitaler and the theology department who have supported today's presentation. I'm also a bit intimidated. Quote, "We'd like you to talk about your overall research throughout your career," was the formulation I was given. I didn't want to do a presentation that was simply like that of an old songwriter sitting at a piano and intoning, quote, "and then I wrote," and then swinging back to the keyboard. I looked for some overarching theme that gave some semblance of unity to what I would share, and decided on call to holy worldliness, which I will explain later on. And I have also decided to put all this in the context of my life, a kind of narrative theology. It is something I've never done before, as I followed for many years an objective professional role in the classroom in which I sought to be simply a very clear describer and explainer, and in the case of controverted questions, a hopefully utterly fair narrator of various positions. I simply found that not offering a personal opinion made for better pedagogy. It just got the students more into thinking, and that's what I wanted. So here is more of my life, told with attention to teaching and research, and for that matter, service too. Here is my outline. First, I'll share a sketch of my life from age 18 to my mid-30s, parts of which represent my own emerging sense of a call to holy worldliness. A brief part two will mention some of my writings and experience. Aspects of this fit the theme too. For example, both of my books on the history of Commonweal magazine are stories of the editor's engagement with literature, the arts, politics, and religion, faith and culture, holy worldliness. Finally, I'll talk about my classroom experience with this theme, how I came to use this phrase, and why I think it is a central affirmation of the Christian tradition. Part one. I was fortunate to grow up in the 1940s and 50s in a family in which faith was intrinsic to life. The second of four children, I attended the Holy Child Sisters St. Leonard's Academy, a great little Catholic school at 39th and Chestnut Streets in West Philadelphia. And that was in the paper before I knew there'd be a couple of Holy Child Sisters in attendance. And then moved on to the Augustinians at Malvern Prep. I entered Villanova as a business student. I enjoyed literature and history more, but I bought the argument that business was practical. As I thought about my life, however, the possibility of a life of service as a priest was periodically surfacing. I was also aware of the reality of a military service obligation, a draft, for which I had, following what is still the mandate, registered at age 18. During the fall semester of my sophomore year at Villanova, I learned of a military option that provided a 6-month rather than 2-year active duty obligation if you volunteered before you were 18 and a half years of age. I calculated that if I volunteered and left school after mid-year exams, I would be finished in time to take two courses at Temple, which had an August summer session. I would return to Villanova in the fall, and by taking a few extra courses, could catch up and graduate with my class. My older brother had shortly before this joined the Navy. My father was sickly, and I didn't want to get dropped off at the train station for military service by my mother, so I got my friend Upton Bell, who's now a talk show host in Boston, to take me to the North Philadelphia station. There, about 50 of us were to gather to be taken to Fort Knox, Kentucky. I was the second to arrive. The first was Benjamin Wilder, an African-American no taller than I, but considerably more muscular. Benny and I had a long chat as we waited. As we finally moved to the train, Benny, unsolicited, said to me, "Anybody give you any trouble, you just tell old Benny and I'll take care of them." Old Benny, of course, was just 18, same as me. In training at the base, we had to do pull-ups, at least three, before going into the mess hall to eat. Benny always did it, we could do them with two arms. Benny always did at least 10 one-arm pull-ups with each arm. No one else was even close to this performance. I never needed the personal insurance policy Benny had so graciously provided. Also, if anything, my religious life was nurtured in the Army. There was a chapel across the road from our barracks that had a 4:30 mass each day, a peaceful respite from basic training. There, a few of us from various units would straggle in, but there was also a group of about 30 who arrived marching and counting cadence. I never solved the mystery of these guys, but they certainly impressed me at the time. The pre-Vatican II liturgy, this was 1957, so clearly pre-Vatican II, was a missa recitata, a Latin language mass recited with the congregation. Very nice. At mail call one day, I also received a nice handwritten note from the registrar at Villanova, Father Burke, saying he was surprised I had left school. It was nice to be remembered. Our platoon was very comfortably integrated, the first time I had had a circle of black friends. We wrapped up basic training with a week in the field, a 20-mile march with weapon and full gear, and an exercise in crawling forward under barbed wire with live machine gun fire 30 inches above our heads. The last, the machine gun fire, I have noted, not entirely in jest, was good training for some moments in academic life. Keep your head down and keep inching forward. My next training was as an artillery survey specialist at Fort Sill, Oklahoma. The Army had been theoretically integrated for 11 years, but no African Americans were part of this new unit on a base with a nearby segregated city. All this training was in peacetime. The biggest hazards at Fort Sill were chiggers and rattlesnakes. I got a heavy dose of the chiggers, which I'll never forget, and saw plenty of rattlesnakes, but had no dangerous encounters. By August, I was finished with active duty and back in school, 6 months older and I think much wiser. My comfortable mainline life had been expanded. That fall, I was hitchhiking a ride to school. I was a day student, and hitchhiking was a fairly standard mode of travel for all my contemporaries. And I got a ride with a classmate, Jack Kearns, who explained that he had to leave his job coaching at St. Aloysius Academy here in Bryn Mawr. I told him I'd love to have that job. He put in a good word for me, and I enjoyed that work for the next 2 years until graduation. I still had not set aside the thought of entering the seminary, and on my 21st birthday in April of senior year, I contacted the Augustinians about the possibility of being admitted to study for the priesthood. I was admitted, as was Bob Wagner, also graduating from Villanova. Bob was an outstanding student, an electrical engineer and physics major, whose highest overall grades had him deliver the student commencement address. Bob had broad interests beyond science, in music, sports, and the intellectual life. 43 of us went off to the Augustinian novitiate in New Hamburg, New York that year. It was a great group and a step in my life that I've never regretted. The year was for prayer, reading, and reflection, though we also had a fiercely competitive basketball league in an unheated barn with a concrete floor. Bob Wagner and I became good friends, and he and I tried to improve a bit on our 2 years of high school Latin during the last few weeks in New Hamburg. We moved on to studies in philosophy at Villanova the next year. The books were all written in Latin, which I was willing to live with, but when it became evident that these books had been written in English and then translated into Latin, I thought there was some madness at work, really. You could see the English idioms that had been put awkwardly into the Latin, and you said, this is crazy. Most of the profs talked through their courses, not imposing the Latin text with much rigor. But one, Father Robert Welsh, played hardball. He always began class by asking if there were any questions, almost never were there, and then called on people to translate and explain specific passages. Bob and I learned that our seminary classmates had Latin skills not much beyond ours, and all of us, Bob and I included initially, all hid behind the person seated in front of us to avoid being called upon. I think Father Welsh enjoyed imposing a kind of benevolent terror in his class. After the first class or two of this, Bob proposed that he and I work together. We lived in St. Rita's, and like all seminarians, were prohibited from being inside another's room. But on the assumption that it would be easier to get forgiveness than permission, we decided to meet in the basement of St. Rita's, which was then one open office for the psychology department, where we would translate the assignment completely and talk it over till we had formatted 3 or 4 good questions. When Father Welsh did his usual, "Are there any questions?" we put up our hands and asked question after question. It was work, but it was fun. My studies were going satisfactorily. However, I had real doubts about my suitability for further progress in the seminary. I talked it over with Father Edwin Stanford. Father Stanford was the president at one point of Villanova University, and Patrick Hayes has written a wonderful book recently entitled A Catholic Brain Trust, The History of the Catholic Commission on Intellectual and Cultural Affairs. Which began in 1945. Father Stanford and John Courtney Murray were the two driving forces with the Commission on Intellectual and Cultural Affairs. And it's nicely in the book I just held up here. So I went to see Father Stanford, who lived actually down the hall from me. And in 3 discussions I talked it over with Father Edwin Stanford in 3 discussions over a period of a couple of months. He was very helpful. I thought more about it into the summer, and in August decided I should withdraw. Since I had taken 3-year temporary vows, I needed a dispensation from these. I learned that things progressed very slowly in August and September in Rome. And I was moved on to Washington while awaiting the necessary paperwork. When classes were beginning, I spoke to the master who was in charge and asked if I could skip the classes so I could get to work sending letters to try to find a job. He agreed to this, and soon my confreres were helping me prepare for my next step. I didn't want to pursue a business career, although later in life I found my business training useful. I had read Jacques Barzun's Teacher in America. I had loved the coaching I had done and concluded to going for teaching. Frank Igo was a seminarian. Some of you know him later as Father Frank Igo, who eventually became the chair of the theology department at Villanova. Frank was in class at Catholic University with a guy named Joe Kirshner, who was the first American purist seminarian, who was persuaded to put in a good word for me at Devon Prep. At the time, I had never even heard of Devon Prep. It was a brand new school. I also applied to Monsignor Bonner High School, which many seminarians had attended. Some of my colleagues also encouraged me to think about being a lay theologian. And when I thought about it, that sounded good to me. Since that would require a graduate degree, I contacted Villanova to register for a graduate theology course. And I also sent a letter to Father Joseph Gilday, who was in administration at Villanova, or had been, asking his advice about my preparation for a possible career as a college teacher of theology. Everyone helped me. I could have made the title of this, "I Get By with the Help of My Friends," but I thought it wasn't quite as intriguing as this call to holy worldliness. Everyone helped. I had to be interviewed by the superintendent of Catholic schools office, and I got a job teaching 10th grade English at Monsignor Bonner. I immediately began part-time graduate theology at Villanova. Father Gilday met me and told me to plan on getting a doctorate if I wanted a career in college teaching. I applied to Notre Dame, and within a week I got a call from the chair of the theology department, who was in Philadelphia and wanted to meet with me. I took the graduate record exam and applied with a nice letter from Father Stanford and got a tuition-free offer from Notre Dame. Villanova heard about this and said they'd give me free tuition if I stayed in their master's program. Sounded good to me. The teaching at Bonner was challenging. It's almost unimaginable. Five classes, 52 students in each class, 260 students. I'm tempted to digress. The first week or so, I gave them an assignment to write a paragraph or two, and I had to consume the next 10 days of my life, day and night, reading through this. Terrible. I found it exhausting but satisfying. In June, Devon Prep contacted me regarding a position teaching history and coaching basketball. Joe Kirshner had recommended me, and so had some of my former St. Aloysius players and their parents. The teaching was fine, but we learned much humility competing in the suburban Catholic League against some schools that were more than 10 times our size. Plus, the coach still had a lot to learn. The good news was that I had begun dating Judy McGrath in August 1962, and we married in August 1963 following her graduation from Rosemont College. A choir of Augustinian seminarians came and sang at the wedding. Five children, 10 grandchildren, plenty of challenges, but every day a joy in the years that have followed. Thank you, Judy, and join me, please. The next year at Devon was fun in the classroom, but more struggles on the court. We opened with two straight wins. Devon was an unusual school. It was very academic. And the only thing, frankly, got them nervous was when we won a couple of ball games. They thought there was an inverse relationship between academics and athletics. Not really. So then we dropped 16 in a row. I left you with two wins. We lost the next 16 in a row. And you played everybody twice. If you got to January and you'd already lost everybody by 20 points, you could look forward to playing all these guys again. So I have lost to all of the name coaches in Philadelphia, Jimmy Lynam, Harry Booth, all these guys, tramped us. I began quietly to work on getting Devon into the Inter-Academic League. I was also the athletic director, which would have been a better fit and would have been fine, although I think the priest would have had none of it because nothing could interfere during the week with the focus on academics. And in the Interac, you had to play ball on Tuesday afternoon. I finished my MA in theology in the summer of 1964. Father Welsh, possibly the best Augustinian theologian at the time, was the prof, and now the books were in English. I wrote a long paper in which, with youthful arrogance, I set out to resolve the problem of evil. Yep. I discovered Robert Hutchins' reading guide on the topic from the Great Book series, and I read St. Augustine, St. Thomas Aquinas, Dostoevsky, and a whole bunch of others. I really worked at it. I presented a summary of the paper in class, drawing the class into the discussion, and concluded by observing that I felt these great minds had not fully solved the problem of evil, and certainly neither had I. One was left with a leap of faith. At the end of class, Father Welsh, who was also the Dean of Arts and Sciences, approached me and asked if I had ever considered teaching in college. When I answered yes, he asked if I thought I could get released from my Devon job and join the theology department at Villanova. The Devon headmaster had been aware of my ultimate plans and wished me well at Villanova. I was assigned to teach freshman moral theology and given a prescribed text and a highly specific syllabus. The text, The Christian Life, written in the preconciliar years, had all the characteristics of legalism, minimalism, and a lack of sacred scripture that are now routinely identified as flaws in such texts of those years. After trying hard to make the text work, I asked the students, somewhat cautiously, because the book had cost $14, which was a lot of money in those days, and I thought, can we really dump this book and change? But I asked the students, and we talked it over, and so we changed to Beyond the Commandments, a more popularly written book that had already picked up the renewal of the council. Excuse me a minute here. The next year, the department did away with a prescribed syllabus and text under the new leadership of Father Jack O'Rourke, a very fine Augustinian priest. I kept Beyond the Commandments the next time around, which the students liked. I knew they did, because I had used an anonymous course review sheet that I called Critique. Within a year, a campus-wide student-run survey of all departments and courses emerged in tabloid form under the title Critique. It had a little edgy tone to it, so I didn't say, I helped launch this thing. My other selected texts were Christian Morality Today by a then unknown young secular priest from Rochester, Charles Curran, a collection of social justice-themed essays, No More Strangers by an equally unknown Josephite priest from Baltimore, Philip Berrigan, with an introduction by Thomas Merton, he was known, and a Today's English Version New Testament from the American Bible Society that I learned we could buy for only 50 cents. I borrowed shamelessly from the German theologian Fritz Tillmann's The Master Calls, in an effort to frame a more biblically inspired Christian ethic. We also used The Church and War, a historical overview that Jim O'Gara at Commonweal had written. I still needed a doctoral degree. I also needed to learn enough French and German to pass reading exams in these languages I had never studied at all. Our first child, Rodger, was born as I was finishing up at Devon. Katie was on the way during my first Villanova year. Judy tutored me in French. I looked into the possibility of doctoral studies in religion at Temple, and again was very lucky. Their program was small, but Dr. Bernard Phillips, the chair, had gotten religion into Temple's core curriculum, had gotten approval to grow to a faculty of 20, with most of the new faculty appointed as tenured full professors representing all traditions, and if I enrolled, I'd be their first Catholic graduate student. In fact, they needed someone, said Dr. Phillips as we chatted nicely. He said, in fact, they needed someone right away to teach a class in contemporary Catholic thought, and they could give me a half-time grad assistantship for doing that. Also, they were becoming state-related, and tuition would become quite reasonable. There was an entrance exam, which I passed, and all this fell into place. We didn't have to move, nor did I have to travel to get that doctorate, and I passed the French exam on the first try, thanks to Judy. By the way, in applying to Temple, I had asked my theology chair at the time, Father Henry Weeks, to write me a recommendation. He agreed, but then came back the next day to say he had talked to Father Robert Regan, OSA, who told him I wasn't allowed to study as a Catholic at Temple unless I had a letter of permission from the Chancellor of the Archdiocese of Philadelphia. At this point, I regretted having asked Father Weeks for his support. But now felt trapped into having to secure the letter of permission. The letter came actually with no trouble from Father John Noon, who later became pastor of our parish church in Ballykinwood and a good friend. My first course at Temple was with John Macquarie, an internationally respected Scottish theologian. The course dealt with Martin Heidegger and Rudolf Bultmann. I knew little about the former and almost nothing about the latter, but I figured I should take the opportunity of studying with this famous visiting prof. The class was large, especially for a grad class, about 30 students. Everybody thought they'd like to be in for Macquarie. I took notes furiously during his lecture, which was followed by questions. The questions asked were long and intricate, with a demonstrated subtext by these students that they clearly already knew a great deal. My nervousness was turning to terror as I thought to myself, what the hell have you gotten yourself into? Can you really cut it in this doctoral program? Finally, with my heart beating fast, I meekly asked my elementary question, what is an existentialist theology? He answered the question at length, but he also, unlike the fairly terse answers he had given my learned colleagues, he answered the question at length, but he also made me feel really good for having asked it. I've never forgotten that feeling. In the years since, I've had little occasion to go back to Heidegger and Bultmann. But I learned that day how I wanted to make my students feel when they would ask me a question. Dr. Leonard Swidler, historian, theologian, and co-editor of the Journal of Ecumenical Studies, arrived at Temple in 1966, and so did lots more Catholic and other graduate students. By the time I finished at Temple, it was the second largest graduate religion program in the United States. I took Swidler's seminar in Vatican I in the fall and his seminar in Vatican II in the spring with a lot of great classmates, including Father Jack McNamee and some other folks. That's where I met up with him. In the Vatican II seminar, I wrote a 70-page paper on the debate and development on birth control in the Council and since the Council. The question was not abstract. In the fall, our family expanded to 4 children with the arrival of twin sons. I concluded that the theology of marriage was radically underdeveloped, that the church had created a message that the avoidance of contraception was the achievement of marital virtue, and that a further step in doctrinal evolution that accepted the responsible use of contraception was appropriate. A year later, when Humanae Vitae rejected the development for change that the Papal Advisory Commission on Birth Control itself had suggested, Father Jack O'Rourke, the theology chair, and I called an open meeting of Villanova's faculty to discuss this. In August 1968, 125 faculty gathered, reflected, and 119 signed a statement of dissent that I had drafted. Mind you, this is August. The faculty aren't all around. This was pretty amazing, 125 faculty gathering for this. I also organized a statement by Philadelphia area professors in the, quote, sacred sciences, philosophy and theology. I didn't give much of a thought to my own vulnerability as an untenured faculty member by these actions. In fact, I hadn't thought of it at all until Bernard Riley, who's sitting right here, and I'm glad you're here, Bernie, and Dan Carroll of the History Department came to my office, told me they were afraid there might be some problems for me, but they were there to say that they would organize the faculty in my support if anything did happen. Riley had a well-earned position as the leader of the faculty. The next year, Father Welsh, by now the president of Villanova, created an institutional planning council with a development committee, an administrative committee, and an academic committee, each with 12 appointed members. I was appointed to the academic committee and served on its subcommittee on the Catholic and Augustinian character of Villanova. I was grateful to Father Welsh for that assignment at that time. Father Larry Gallen of biology, a prof from classics who left Villanova the next year, and I were the subcommittee, the three of us. We received 125 communications from across the university. Amazing, thoughtful, articulate, long things of input. And the whole academic committee got drafted into working on the Middle States evaluation of 1970. Ooh. Father Gallen and I drafted a paragraph on the Catholic and Augustinian character of Villanova, which was incorporated into the mission statement of the university, and there it's resided for many years. I linked up my committee work with my temple studies, and for the seminar on religion in America, wrote a paper on the identity crisis in Catholic higher education, which was published in the quarterly journal of the NCEA, the National Catholic Education Association. I also published a couple of my other temple course papers, Artificial Insemination Husband, AIH Revisited, in the Homiletic and Pastoral Review, and a John Calvin commentary on Pope Paul VI's letter on clerical celibacy in the American Benedictine Review. During my first year at Villanova, I had gotten my first article on parish school boards in the Journal of the Pennsylvania Catholic Education Association. The article was read with some delight by a young, change-oriented curate in our local parish who got three pillars of the parish, just really good, terrific, admirable guys, with an interest in implementing the ideas in the article to include me in a meeting with the pastor. Parish school boards, nothing too radical. Let's all sit down. We'll chat about this. We'll come up with ideas. We can all work together and make things better. That's the tenor of it, really. When we entered his office, the then pastor, we were seated and we indicated the subject we wished to discuss, at which point he promptly stood up and screamed, "Get out! Nobody's gonna tell me what to do." Yep, unbelievable. When someone later asked him about Vatican II, he responded quite seriously. He was awaiting the full implementation of Vatican I. The only formal feedback I received on the parish school board's article was a really nice letter in the campus mail from Father Louis Rangione, the Falvey librarian. Very nice. I was pleased when Dr. Swidler accepted my request to be my mentor for my dissertation. During an exploration of the topic, he pointed out that the 50-year anniversary of the lay-edited journal Commonweal was approaching, and no one had done a history of it. I was quite familiar with the journal and loved the idea. Just very quickly, Commonweal magazine, I know there's some students and maybe some others who aren't familiar with it. It's a lay-edited, independent Catholic journal, at that point a weekly, and doesn't have any church money or organizational support, but it's had a very distinguished history since 1924 when it started. I was quite familiar with the journal and loved Swidler's idea. It was, however, a vast project. Just the bound volumes of the journal added up to 60,000 pages. Past and present editors agreed to interviews, and they opened the files of the journal to me. I turned every page, selectively read every volume, and eventually distilled the 100 bound volumes to 1,100 3x5 cards with subjects, thoughts, and notations. Yep, for the students present, that's how we really had to do things in those days. Yeah. I was proceeding slowly with the project when Len Swidler called to let me know he was leaving in 10 months to spend 2 years in Germany. I dropped all other commitments. I still had the teaching, but I got out of everything else. Worked constantly with great support and feedback from Len, and delivered the 330-page finished project to Len and the committee members, Father Gerard Sloyan and Dr. Dennis Clark. I also gave a finished copy to the folks at Commonweal in New York. During the mad dash to finish the dissertation, Judy and I attended a small dinner party at a neighbor's home. There we met Norman Yelm and his wife Ingalil. Norman was the editorial director of Fortress Press. He asked, what was I working on? And I told him of my deep immersion in the Commonweal story and the deadline I was working toward. 2 months later, I had a chance meeting with Norman in the neighborhood hardware store, Henry's Hardware, up the street from the Bala Theater in the old days. When I told him I had finished and defended the dissertation, he asked what I intended to do with it. I answered that I was just beginning to think about that, and I'd be grateful for any advice he might have. He asked if he could read it, and that evening I dropped a copy off to him. 3 weeks later, he contacted me and said that he and others had read it, liked it, and if I were open to it, Fortress Press, a Lutheran press, by the way, would like to publish it. I readily agreed. The contract was for a run of 3,000 copies. But 3 months later, Norman informed me that Commonweal had also liked it, and they wanted 5,000 copies, so the print run was now 8,000. It came out just in time for Commonweal's 50th anniversary. Len Swidler had called the perfect play. The book was widely reviewed, including a lengthy positive review by Monsignor John Tracy Ellis, who was regarded as the Dean of Historians of American Catholicism. It was almost magical. Wow. Part two. Since time is limited, and I do want to say something about the call to holy worldliness, let me simply list some topics that I'd be glad to come back to in discussion if you wish. Villanova's concerned citizens and the first Vietnam protest on campus. Second, Father Art Ennis and other theology department chairs of distinction. The bicentennial lecture series and book. That would be this one. And the contributors were Sidney Alstrom, Martin Marty, Benjamin Mays, Michael Novak, David O'Brien, Rosemary Ruther, and Mark Tannenbaum. We could talk more about that. I've also added how Villanova even made money on the project. The founding at Villanova of Horizons, the journal of the College Theology Society, with co-editor Bernie Prusak, who's just an amazing guy, as some of you in the room know. And here's what the first volume, the first number of Horizons looked like, with some great contributors, I noticed. John Cogley, his book Catholic America, and my later research on him, which led eventually to this book here. How the theology department has gone through 4 name changes during my years. Yep. need be, I can go through and tick off when and how all those changed. The second Commonweal book, after a while, 20 years had gone by, and I thought I could just add a little chapter to update the other book. But when I started to write it, it just kept getting longer, and it turned into a book in its own right. So Being Catholic, with a nice introduction by Larry Cunningham from Notre Dame. And that took the story of Commonweal from the 70s to the 90s. Another great thing was a wonderful 10-day international conference on enculturation held at the Tantour Ecumenical Center overlooking Bethlehem in the Holy Land. And Judy was able to go, and marvelous thing. And we got a, let me see here. This is one of the books came out of it. And I was amazed to see when I looked in it in preparing for today, here's a picture of all the kind of interesting folks who gathered at that special event. Working with the American Catholic Historical Society and transitioning its journal records into American Catholic Studies with Villanova's help. And working with co-editor Margaret McGinnis and now Tom Resnick and Nick Rademacher and Leanne McCabe. Just a great experience. Another storyline, having lunch by chance in the SAC lunchroom. For those who don't know it, that's the faculty office building for arts and sciences, has a small lunchroom in the bottom floor. And Walt Kahn and I were there looking for a place to sit down. And there was nowhere to sit, so we had to cast around. And these two guys said, well, here, sit here. And it was Dan and Phil Berrigan. Dan was a visiting prof, and his brother Phil had come by to visit. And so we had some fun times talking with those guys. And in a way, this led to my research. I later followed up with Dan and a lot of others and pieced together some research in an article that showed how the New Yorker had not gotten the Dan Berrigan story straight. And I could come back to that. 4 articles I've written in recent years dealing with bishops, entitled Distrusteeism, Bishops Should Marry, Communal Bishops and the Future of Catholicism, and I didn't come up with this title, somebody else did, but How to Build a Better Bishop. And finally, working with a long list of great Villanova faculty colleagues in the department, in the college, in the university, in the AAUP, the Faculty Council, the University Senate, Faculty Congress, University Rank and Tenure Committee, and a lot of other stuff like that. Part 3, and it'll be brief. Becoming who we are, or who we are meant to be, is the fundamental challenge in life. What is the world, and how should it be related to, is at least one fundamental question. In a Cross Currents article entitled Religious Life and Christian Vocation, I've got it up here in the corner, I argued that what comprises much of the history of Christian spirituality can be read as an evolving process of relating to the world. From the solitary world of the Desert Fathers to the communal world of Saint Benedict and Western monasticism, to the forays into the world of the mendicant orders with a return to their center of gravity in the monastery, to ongoing engagement in the world with the Jesuits and St. Ignatius. I included Martin Luther and John Calvin in the treatment and found them, in one sense, Ignatian. I picked up the phrase "call to holy worldliness" from the social-minded evangelical theologian Richard J. Mao's book by that title. It seemed to really communicate very effectively with my students. They liked the way he sorted out the various biblical uses of the term world, among other things. First, there is a kind of worldliness that the Bible condemns, that which simply adopts the values of a sinful social order. Thus, the Apostle John told the early Christians that they ought not to, quote, love the world or the things in the world. A second sense of the world in the Bible has neither a negative nor a positive connotation. That simply has to do with geography. Matthew says, the gospel of the kingdom will be preached throughout the whole world. But a third sense does carry a positive meaning. In this sense of world, it is proper for Christians to love the world. Indeed, in this sense, God himself is a lover of the world. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son. The Creator God, who judged his creation to be very good at its beginning, has reaffirmed its fundamental worth by sending his Son to renew it. Christians who join this process and pray with Jesus, "Thy kingdom come," are also pledging to work now toward a world in which qualities of peace, justice, reconciliation, and caring are present. To be sure, this calls for loving the neighbor whom we encounter, but it also calls for loving the neighbor whom we do not directly encounter. It calls for attending to the social structures of society, economic, political, educational, I would include ecclesiastical, healthcare delivery, and more that impact on our neighbor, whether we ourselves directly encounter that neighbor or not. If we truly care about the neighbor, we have to care about the structures that impact on the neighbor. That short sentence I probably said in class more than almost any other. All this is engaged in the ordinary pattern of life involving work, family, and community. Both people and structures may be impacted by our work, which always includes striving to be really good at one's jobs. Many students had never considered that there might be religious meaning intrinsically present in their career paths, and that there was a call to holy worldliness. This call to holy worldliness is really the fundamental message of the Second Vatican Council, and a call that Pope Francis has been emphasizing. Thomas Merton, in his introduction to Philip Berrigan's No More Strangers, wrote of the importance of sharing the message that, quote, ordinary life, with its work, its insecurity, and its inevitable sacrifices, is for the Christian just as much a part of the sacred realm as anything else, because, like everything else, it has been consecrated to God by the incarnation, the death, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. The call of all, as Merton put it so well, is, quote, to the world of everyday reality, of common duty, of work, of play, of sorrow, of joy. It is this call to holy worldliness that remains the great challenge. Thank you.
Okay. I don't if you want to field questions openly or want to just have further discussion?
We'll do formal questions briefly, and then we'll give you a chance to escape. And anybody who wants to talk more, I'll be happy to talk. Bernie?
Well, Professor Riley, yes.
A noble guy like you should rest for just a minute. I'll give you a chance to do that.
Yeah.
I know you're old because you grew up in the same church I did. I found it very interesting because I know most of the guys that you're talking about. Mm-hmm. Villanova guys, that is.
Sure.
To reflect on how many good things God done.
Mm-hmm.
And that was in what was a damn near impossible format. Yeah. Second, you know, I would like to suggest, might happen anyway, but I would like to suggest that you make sure a copy of your paper goes to be form a part of the Augustine archives, because you know someday somebody's going to write a good book about the history of Villanova that hasn't been done yet.
Well, thank
you. And your story belongs in there.
Well, I'm honored to have the archivist of the university in the back row
here. Yes, I knew he is.
Father Dennis Gallagher. So thank you for your presence, and I'd be happy to share a copy with Father
Another
Gallagher.
Another reason why that manuscript should be preserved, because it tells the story of Judy,
mm-hmm.
and of my wife,
mm-hmm.
yeah.
and of Dan Carroll's wife.
Yeah, great people.
And a lot of women,
mm-hmm.
who contributed indirectly, perhaps, mm-hmm. if that's not condescending, but you know what I mean, to an enormous number of good things that got done.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And somebody's going to write a decent book about their contribution someday.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah, I feel privileged to have lived exactly the years I've lived. I'd say that. I hope to have a few more, but so far, so good. Anybody else?
Yeah, please. Hi, I'm a guest here. I heard about the American Catholic Historical Society. I was on the internet, so I'm really happy to be here, and thank you for sharing everything. My question is, I did not grow up in the same church as you. I'm 39 years old. I've been married for 13 years. And it's interesting to me, I had actually left the church and cradle Catholic, had left for a while, came back very strongly in college, and kind of became just I don't have the academic background you have, really just via the sidelines. Theology is my hobby, you know what I mean? I just study it. I'm a minor little guy apologist. So my question, I guess, would be, so in the 13 years that I've been married and before I got married, it sounds like it was a real landmark or had a big... It was definitely something that impacted you, the work that you did in the reaction to humanity defect. And those are the things I've read about that at the time. Again, I wasn't there, but to try to understand. And so my experience has been since, again, only 14 years ago, you know, I was preparing for marriage. I was looking at, you know, the different options of speaking. So with the types of natural family planning that there are now, you know, simple thermal method, the NAPRO, we read about a lot, the highly accurate methods. I guess I'm wondering, like, would you have had, my understanding is it wasn't like that then. Now it's a lot different. I'm wondering if you would have had the same, you know, reactions. Do you think the climate would have been that way?
I think your perception that things are better on that front than they were is correct. And I think, you know, the reliability of those methods has improved considerably as far as I can determine. What the question amounts, and I don't want to get too intricately into the moral theology of it, but that, is there a morally significant difference between this and other non-abortifacient means of birth regulation? Because on close scrutiny, the difference between kind of the official position and the dissenting, the then dissenting position is really rather modest. I mean, there's all kinds of areas of agreement. The affirmation of the goodness of children, and what it boils down to is seeing the question of what some would call the single act analysis rather than the overall marital context. So there's no doubt that procreation is part of the overall marriage context. Does that require, as the official position seems to mandate, that every single act of marital sexual intercourse be, quote, open to procreation? That's the essence of it. And I think there's still a strong practical consensus in many quarters that does not see a morally significant difference. What I feared in 1968, and it went beyond our immediate context, although there was an immediate context, I thought it would be a pastoral disaster, and I did not want to see that. I'm grateful to have been born in the Catholic Church. I hope to die in the Catholic Church. But as you may know, between 1968 and 1975, in the United States, about 20% of Catholics stopped going to church. And the most sophisticated analysis, Andrew Greeley, the late Andrew Greeley, did a long analysis of that. And he determined, because there's a kind of interesting question to settle there, did the fallout of Catholics at that point in time reflect kind of a failure of Vatican II or humanae vitae or what? And nobody's really challenged, to my knowledge, with effective data, Greeley's analysis that shows that the real fallout began after humanae vitae, and that the immediate impact of the council was in fact positive. And Greeley argues that there's a kind of combined positive reaction to the council and even more negative reaction to humanae vitae. I'm just describing this historically and sociologically at this point. So it's painful, I think, that a lot of people had their religious identity and roots damaged in that time period. So I think, I came at it as a pastoral question. But yes, I think you make a contribution in saying that it appears that these methods, have improved considerably. So thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah. Maybe one more and then we'll stop. But Jerry or Sue?
No,
yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Is this the age before beauty?
Yeah. I'm sure. Rodger, I just want to ask advice. So what does the call to holy worldliness require of us? I was hoping that you would
do a little more
right
with that.
Yeah. What is demanded? What is required?
I think operationally, the idea of the relationship to the neighbor understood in the way I perhaps too briefly gave it in the paper, that the neighbor we encounter, most of my students always got that. They had picked all that up before they walked into my classroom. The idea that that this structural kind of thing was new to them. What did these structures mean anyway? And frankly, I had some pretty good success, I think, at times trying to work from structures that they could control or impact already themselves. I didn't bore you with all of those committee assignments, but I got put on a committee on Greek life at one point where we're going to eliminate the fraternities and sororities. I've even been to, you won't believe this, I have been to sorority rush parties as an observer. In any event, all of this, I was able to enter into some dialogue with students about these are structures that you can control and influence. And, you know, how are you setting that up? Are you building people in to enhance community, or are you manipulating it in a way that, that is not serving community? And I think they kind of got the idea. And the idea that the theology of work was kind of new to them, frankly, and the idea that being a really good accountant and serving the people who you serve in that job is of religious meaning was something they hadn't thought about before. They had it, you know, it, they had a kind of, I guess, sacral, secular division that a lot of, and there's a number of my colleagues in theology here, I know all of you folks are working to deal with that in various ways. But there's still work to be done, is my experience from talking with students. So all that, I think, and the idea of just, you know, there's all that ambiguity religiously about what does the world mean and how should I feel about this and is it okay to be worldly and if so, in what sense? It all seemed to connect in the classroom, was my experience at least. So I hope that was something concrete on that. By the way, the first Vietnam protest at Villanova, we didn't go back to that one. There had never been any protest, as far as I know, before that. It was a very radical protest. Nine of us, and there was a student group called the Concerned Citizens, and Father Jim Ryan was the student life guy at the time, and Jim came to me and said, would I be the moderator of the Concerned Citizens? I said, I'll work with them, but I don't think I want to moderate anything. So this big, on Thursdays every week, everyone's schedule was set up so that at 10:30, everybody on the whole campus was off. And people would just mill around, down around outside Doherty Hall. And I think Dan Riggin was there. I don't know who else, a few others who might still be around here.
Jack Duty?
Duty, maybe.
Fresh out of Notre Dame.
I think Father Jack Deacon, if I recall.
Yeah.
I think there were nine. I remember counting. There were nine of us, students and faculty. And we simply stood across the porch. It still looks the same on Doherty Hall. And we had a sign there that said, we are thinking about the war in Vietnam. And we just stood there like this. That was it. Welcome to Radical Villanova. Well, thank you very much for coming. This has been wonderful. I appreciate it.